Hello students, I welcome you to this e-learning lecture. Today we are going to discuss the poem 3 Years She Grew in Sun and Shower, written by the great romantic poet William Wordsworth. Students, I am Vinita Gupta, Associate Professor, Department of English, Government PG College, Sector 1, Panchkula. Here you can see William Wordsworth. And on the right hand side, you can see Lake District. This was the place where Wordsworth was born and where he spent last 50 years of his life. He was very much attached to his birthplace. As I have told you that William Wordsworth was a great romantic poet and he was one of the founders of English Romanticism. Now let us understand what is Romanticism or what is Romantic Age. Students, Romantic Age was a period in the history of English literature in the late 18th century. And Romanticism was a movement in English literature which originated as a reaction against Enlightenment, which was an age of reason and logic. Wordsworth, along with Coleridge, felt that too much bondage of logic and reason and rules and customs, they fettered free human spirit. So they wanted to bring poetry out of these chains of reason, and they thought that poetry should be written in the language of common man. So they gave stress on feelings, imagination in their poetry, and they brought poetry closer to common man. So this is Romanticism in English literature. And William Wordsworth was born in 1770 at Cockermouth, Cumberland, Lake District. And then he went for studies at St. John's College, Cambridge. From there, he went on a walking tour of France, Switzerland, and Italy because nature was closer to his heart and he wanted to explore all the places which were renowned for their beauties of nature. He married in 1802 to his childhood friend Mary Hutchinson, and the last 50 years of his life he spent in the Lake District of England, first at Dove Cottage, Grasmere, and then at Rydal Mount till his death in 1815. And he remained a poet laureate from 1843 to 1850. This is the residence, Rydal Mount, where Wordsworth lived for the last periods of his life with his sister Dorothy. And Wordsworth, though, started writing poetry at an early age, but his mature poetic career began in 1797, and he was at his peak of his poetic career during 1797 to 1800. And during this period, his greatest work of literature called Lyrical Ballads came out. The first volume was published in 1798 in collaboration with Coleridge. And this collection contained two famous poems, one by William Wordsworth, Tintern Abbey, and another by Coleridge, The Rime of Ancient Mariner. The second volume of Lyrical Ballads came out in 1800, and this volume contained an extended preface by William Wordsworth, and it also included the new poems like Lucy, The Fountain, Matthew, Nutting, etc. And in the preface to Lyrical Ballads, Wordsworth explained his poetic philosophy. He wrote in the preface that poetry should be written in the real language of man. It is, I quote, the spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings, and it takes its origin from emotion recollected in tranquility. So this was the personal poetics of William Wordsworth, and he felt that poetry should flow spontaneously from a human heart, and it emerges from the emotions which are recollected when we are at peace with ourselves. These are another poetic volumes of William Wordsworth, and the containing another famous poems of Wordsworth, the Ode Intimations of Immortality, Ode to Duty, Happy Warrior, and its very famous semi-autobiographical poem, The Prelude, was published after his death. And one thing more I would like to add here, that Wordsworth along with Coleridge and Southey came to be known as lake poets because all these poets made their residence in the Lake District. Let us have a look at some of the chief characteristics of William Wordsworth. As you will come to understand while reading the poem, that Wordsworth was the greatest poet of nature and he loved nature very much. Nature was very dear to him and he felt that nature was our teacher, mother and guide. And he was not only physically in love with nature, but he understood its relationship to man also. And he also felt there is the presence of a spirit, a divine spirit in all the objects of nature. And this doctrine of nature is called pantheism. Wordsworth was a poet of man. He brought poetry closer to common man. And he wrote about rustic life because he thought that urbanization, industrialization has made man materialistic and the modern man is cut off from nature. So in his poetry, we can see that Wordsworth had a great gift of imagination and he was a meditative poet. In his poetry, you will also see the philosophy of life. He had a better understanding of human life, its sufferings, and he felt that nature can give us a release from all the sorrows and sufferings of life. And in his poetry, we will also see that there are autobiographical elements. Let us have a look at his love of nature, that he was a worshipper of nature and he was a high priest. And during his college days, he went on walking tour of Europe to Italy, France, Switzerland, as I have told you. And this deepened his love for nature and love for common man. Students, William Wordsworth didn't have a sensual pleasure in the objects of nature. Rather, nature was a living personality for William Wordsworth. And he thought that the company of nature gives joy to human heart. And as I have discussed with you already about pantheism, he felt that a divine spirit exists in the objects of nature. As in Tintern Abbey, he has written, I quote, emotion and a spirit rose through all things. Nature has a great influence on human beings. Nature never did betray the heart that loved her. So he told to his sister Dorothy, and these are the lines quoted from Tintern Abbey, that nature never deceives a person who really loves it. Nature also reciprocates this love. The poem Tintern Abbey can be called that it is a complete expression of Wordsworth's philosophy of nature. Let me quote a few lines from Tintern Abbey. You try to understand these lines. I quote, these beauteous forms. He is writing about the objects of nature, the beautiful objects of nature, like sun, moon, hills, air, valleys, trees, clouds, all the objects of nature. He calls these beauteous forms, through a long absence, have not been to me, as is a landscape to a blind man's eye. But often in lonely rooms and amid the din of towns and cities, I have owed to them in hours of weariness, sensations sweet, that whenever a person is tired of city life, he can feel pleasures, sweet sensations by the memory of the objects of nature. So this is his philosophy of nature. Now let us go through the poem 3 years she grew in sun and shower. This is a poem which is based on a little girl, Lucy, and this poem was composed in 1798, and it was first published in the Lyrical Ballads, the second volume, in 1800. And this poem, 3 years she grew in sun and shower, is one of the 5 Lucy poems. The theme of the poem is that nature has a great influence on human life. It has the power to impart education better than any human being. The poet believes that if a child is given freedom to play in the lap of nature, he or she will be a better person in his life. So this poem is a sort of, in the form of a lyrical elegy, because it is written on the untimely demise of a little girl, an imaginary child of 3 years old, and her name is Lucy. This poem reflects Wordsworth's view of harsh reality of life, that is, death is the ultimate end of human life. Nobody can escape it. And this poem so presents the universal truth of the nature of life, that is, man is born from nature, he is nurtured and sustained by nature, and in the end, he is destined to return to it. So a person should not waste his or her life in materialistic pursuit. Rather, he should understand this harsh reality of life, and he should cherish the beauty of nature. As I have told you that this poem is a lyric. So what is a lyric? Lyric is a verse or a poem which was meant to sung to the accompaniment of a musical instrument, and this instrument used to be usually a lyre. Again, a lyric expresses intense personal emotions, thoughts and feelings of the poet. And there are a few type forms of poetry which can be lyrical, like elegies, odes and sonnets. Students, every poem written by the great artist have some literary devices to accentuate the meaning of their thoughts, the poems. And one of these literary devices is personification. You will see in this poem, the personification has been used very extensively. Personification is a literary device and it is a type of metaphor. In it, the poet attributes human qualities to animals, inanimate objects or abstract ideas. For example, in the poem Under Consideration, the poet says, "Then nature said." This phrase shows that here nature has been given the human quality of speech. Nature can speak. So nature has been personified here. Other literary devices are similes and metaphor, which are used in your poem. Simile is a figure of speech, which is a form of comparison between two dissimilar things. And simile makes a direct comparison with the help of the use of words like, as, or then. For example, we will see in the poem the phrase is used, "She is sportive as the fawn." Another figure of speech, a little dissimilar from simile, is metaphor. It is again a type of comparison, but here comparison is implied. That is, here the meaning is conveyed by an expression that describes a person or object by referring to something that is considered to have similar characteristics to that person or object. But here the poet or the writer doesn't use the words like, as, or then, as are used in simile. For example, he calls the girl Lucy a lovelier flower. Rather than saying she is as beautiful as a flower, he says that she is a lovely flower. A Alliteration is also a figure of speech, and the meaning of alliteration is the repetition of same consonant sounds at the beginning of words that are in close proximity to each other or stretched syllables to create more rhythmic effect in a poem. Alliteration is a device, students, which gives musicality to the poem. The phrases like breathing balm, here the b sound is repeated. Silent sympathy, s sound is repeated. Beauty bowl, b sound is repeated. Now, after having these technical terms and understanding of these terms, let us start with our poem, which is prescribed in your syllabus. 3 years she grew in sun and shine. The first stanza goes like this. 3 years she grew in sun and shower, then nature set. A lovelier flower on earth was never sown. This child I to myself will take. She shall be mine, and I will make a lady of my own. Here you see that nature is speaking, and this we have called personification. He calls Lucy a lovelier flower. This is the metaphorical use of the term. And you can see some words are underlined. These words show the rhyme scheme of the poem. Char rhymes with flower. Sown rhymes with own. Take rhymes with make. So I have given these rhyming words the same alphabets. A, B, C, C, B. This rhyme scheme can be seen in every stanza of the poem. Let us try to explain the poem. 3 years she grew in sun and shower. She is here used for Lucy. That for 3 years of her early life, she grew up, she developed in the lap of nature, in the company of nature. Sun and shower. Shower is rain. So she grew up in open spaces. She was not confined to the rooms in the city homes. Then nature said. Then nature started speaking. And these are the thoughts of the poet. We can say that the poet himself thought that he will take his child in the lap of nature, in the valleys, away from the city life, so that she can develop into a fully grown, a beautiful girl, a beautiful maiden. The nature said, a lovelier flower, that Lucy was a very beautiful child, and such a beautiful child was never sown. Sown is born, never born on this earth. This child I to myself will take. And nature decided to adopt this child as her own. She shall be mine. That Lucy will be growing up in the lap of nature. Nature will be her mother, and I will make a lady of my own. And nature wanted to act as a teacher also for that lady, for that girl. When she will grow up, she will grow up in a beautiful lady, and that lady will be according to the perceptions, according to the desires, according to the thoughts of nature, that all her life she will remain away from the dull and drab materialistic world which the city people are leading. Next stanza. Myself will to my darling be both law and impulse. The poet felt that Lucy can learn both law, discipline, and impulse, freedom, amid the objects of nature. That is, when a child is given a chance to grow up freely, that he or she can become a perfect human being. Because in the objects of nature, we can learn both the things, we can get freedom, and we can learn the importance of freedom also. We can learn discipline or restraint in the objects of nature. And with me, the girl, in rock and plain, in earth and heaven, in glade and bar, shall feel an overseeing power to kindle or restrain. See the phrase used, overseeing power. That is the pantheism of William Wordsworth, that he felt that in every object of nature, there lives a divine spirit. And that divine spirit is overseeing, that is caring for human being. Whether the person lives in rocks, in mountains or plains, in earth, on the earth or in the sky, in glade or bar, in the open spaces, in the forest or the shady, under the shady trees. Everywhere the divine spirit lives and it overlooks all the activities of human beings and it kindles them, it pampers them and it restrains them. That is, it keeps them in check also, that their freedom may not go uncontrolled, because uncontrolled freedom also makes a human being unruly, barbaric. So in the lap of nature, a person can learn, can get all the education which can make a perfect human being. She shall be sportive as the fawn. Nature is continuing her monologue here. She is speaking, she shall be sportive, that she will be in a playful mood in the lap of nature as the fawn, and she will feel like the young one of a deer. As the young one of a deer plays sportively over hills and mountains and in the valleys, in the same manner a young child, a little child, can feel happiness when he or she is left freely to enjoy in the objects of nature. That wild with glee across the lawn or up the mountain springs. As a fawn moves over the mountains and it plays in the mountain springs, the water sources, or it moves across the green grassy fields, wild with glee, with extreme happiness. In the same manner, Lucy will also feel extremely happy when she will be left free to grow up and she will be left free in the company of nature. And hers shall be the breathing balm and hers the silence and the calm of mute insensate things. And there nature will act as a balm to her also. It will soothe her in the times of trouble. It will comfort her. The air will act as a balm to her. As we apply balm when we are feeling pain in our body, in the same manner when Lucy will be suffering, nature will apply that balm to her and it will relieve her of her pain and hers the silence and the calm. And she will also learn the importance of silence and she can be tension free in the objects of, among the objects of nature, of mute insensate things. The very objects of nature which are mute, which are silent and insensate, which are without any senses, all these objects of nature will teach Lucy the importance of silence and calmness. The floating clouds their state shall lend to her, for her the willow band. Nor shall she fail to see, even in the motions of the storm, grace that shall mold the maiden's form by silent sympathy. The poet feels that even the floating clouds, the clouds which are moving in the sky at their own will, they will give to Lucy their state, their dignified movement. That is, Lucy can learn how to move in a dignified manner from the movement of the clouds. And she will learn the importance of humility from the willow plant, the willow band. Willow is a plant which has a flexible stem and it can move up and down freely. In the same manner, Lucy can learn the importance of being humble from the willow plant. And nor shall she fail to see even in the motions of the storm. Here, William Wordsworth says that even the destructive aspects of nature, the seemingly destructive aspects of nature, like the stone, they also have some educational qualities, some educational features for human beings. Even the movement of the stone can give us an education, can give us a lesson of grace, and that grace can mold, can change our personalities, the maiden's form, and this grace will seep into our forms, in our bodies, in our personalities by silent sympathy. Very silently, by silent understanding, when a person grows up amid the objects of nature, then his or her personality automatically becomes perfect. The stars of midnight shall be dear to her. But Lucy will also learn to love the night sky which is full of stars. That will be dear to her. She will love that starry nights. And she shall lean her ear in many secret places where rivulets dance their wayward round. And Lucy will also learn to enjoy the music of nature, the music of flowing rivulets, which are flowing waywardly, willfully over the stones lying in the mountains. Just like it feels as if rivulets are dancing, here again the rivulets are personified. That Lucy will learn to listen to this secret music of nature, and this music will also pass into her face. It will be reflected into her face, that her personality will become beautiful like the sweet music of the flowing rivers and rivulets in the mountains. The beauty born of murmuring sound shall pass into her face, that it will be expressed in her beautiful face. And vital feelings of delight shall rear her form to stately height, her virgin bosom swell. Such thoughts to Lucy I will give while she and I live together here in this happy dell. So nature says that when Lucy and I will be living together in these happy valleys, that Lucy will be living and will be growing up in the valleys and among the mountains, that she will get all the beautiful thoughts. Her body will grow up fully, as well as her thoughts will also become beautiful. That is, she will become beautiful both inside and outside. And vital feelings of delight, the feelings of happiness, which are very important, which are very necessary for a human being to behave normally, to lead a healthy life. Those feelings will come into Lucy naturally when she will be with the objects of nature. And these feelings of delight will be helpful, will rear her form to a stately height, will be helpful for her to grow up into a beautiful maiden, a virgin bosom swell, to a fully grown beautiful lady. So such is the plan of nature for Lucy, for the young child of 3, that when she will be given the freedom to grow up in the open fields, in the grassy fields, and she will be kept away from the classroom education, that education is much more better than any education any human being can give in the cities. So this was the speech by nature, thus nature speak. And the poet heaves a deep sigh here, sigh of grief. The work was done, as is seen by the use of these dashes. The work was done. The nature wanted to do her work, to make Lucy grow up into a beautiful child. And the work was done. As it says, how soon my Lucy's race was run. That Lucy's life on this earth ended very soon. That she was not given a chance to grow up among the human beings, and nature took her with her, as she said. she died. Lucy died at a very young age of 3 and left to me this heath, this calm and quiet scene, the memory of what has been and never more will be. So these lines contain the pathos of the poem, the grief of the poet. It says, Lucy died at a very young age and left this nature, these beauties of nature for me to enjoy. This heat, this barren space, that is, the world has become barren for me now. The world has lost its charm for the poet also. This calm place, this peaceful place, this quiet scene, all these are left for the poet to live the life alone among these objects. The memory of what has been and never more will be. And he is also left with the memory of Lucy and his plans, the plans which he had made for that beautiful child. Those plans had remained unaccomplished, unrealized, and only the memories of that time spent with the girl has been left with him and never more will be. And that thing cannot be converted into a reality now, because Lucy has died and the thoughts have become a thing of past, and all the things are left with the poet himself. So poet here laments his loneliness, the loss of his child. To conclude, we can say that Lucy poem, or this poem, 3 years she grew in sun and shower, is an elegiac poem, because here the poet laments the death of the child, Lucy. And this is also a lyrical ballad, because the poem expresses intensely personal feelings of the poet over the death of the little child. And this is a sort of ballad also, because here he is telling the story of poignant death of the child. Nature in the poem has been personified, and throughout the poem you have seen that it seems that nature is a living presence in the poem, and which is invested with all the human characteristics of thinking and feeling. This poem consists of 7 stanzas, and each stanza has 6 lines. And the rhyme scheme in the poem, as we have seen in the first stanza, is AABCCB. And you have seen the poet has used a very simple language, but the language is very intense, it is moving and musical. So this is the poem, 3 years she grew in sun and shower. And here I have jotted down a few questions to test your understanding of the poem. I hope that you will attempt all these questions and you will submit your assignments to your class teachers. So these are the references from which I have taken the pictures and some of the material for this presentation. And with this, we come to an end of this discussion, and I hope that you might have understood this poem. Thank you, students. Thank you very much.